This guide is going to show you how anyone, and I mean anyone, can beat the Deep Stone Crypt raid in D2. Even if you've never raided before, I assure you, you can beat this raid. If you're in an LFG team looking for your first ever clear of Deep Stone Crypt, and someone on the team wants to know,
"Hey man, have you ever done this raid at all before?"
I want you to say to them, with confidence,
"No, I haven't, but I've watched Fallout's noob guide, so I'm basically an expert, and that's all you need to f***ing know."
Alright, now before you skip ahead to learn about a particular encounter, timestamps are in the video description, please watch this one part that explains three player roles that will come up repeatedly in this raid. I'ma simplify them very generally and elaborate more per each encounter. Role number one, operator, aka the red buff. Your job is to be the dude that every now and then needs to shoot a glowing number pad. Role number two, scanner, aka the yellow buff. Your job is to be the dude that sees things that glow yellow and tell the rest of your team exactly what is glowing yellow. Role number three, suppressor, aka the blue buff. Your job is to shoot the boss from underneath robot beach ball drones and stun him so the rest of your team can continue to do their jobs. These three roles appear in almost every encounter, so good to kinda know about them up front. There's also these terminals that glow yellowish that appear in multiple encounters. These terminals are used to transfer any of the three buffs I just mentioned. Example, do you need to pass your scanner buff to another player on your team? And you may have to. Dunk it off yourself into the terminal, and your friend, who can be at any other terminal on the map, can then pick up the buff themselves. That'll come into play later. All right, before you get to the first encounter, you gotta locate the Deep Stone Crypt. Clear adds out in the Eventide Ruins, proceed into the area through the door, and you'll be outside in the freezing cold. You now need to race on your sparrows from heat bubble to heat bubble until you reach the final door that leads to the crypt. When you are out in the freezing cold between heat bubbles, you'll get a debuff called Frostbite located in the bottom left-hand corner of your screen. If that Frostbite number ever climbs all the way up to 10, you'll die. Hang out in a heat bubble for a little bit until the Frostbite debuff goes away. Then once again, take out your sparrow and race to the next bubble. You can clear adds if they are hanging out in a bubble annoying you, because getting rid of them makes things easier. You can see a slightly sped up, edited version of the route you need to take on screen now. When you reach the final heat bubble, remember to find and open the hidden chest before going through the door to the first encounter. You don't need to do this, but the hidden chest has stuff you could find valuable. The chest is up on the top of the cliff right next to the final heat bubble. Alright, now you're in the first real encounter. Disable Crypt Security. Remember the three roles I told you about in the first section of this guide, which you definitely did not skip over? Two of them come into play here, the operator and the scanner. Your overall goal for this encounter is to shoot and break six very large fuses in the center of the arena, and the majority of your time here will be spent uncovering those fuses so that you can damage them. Let's go over the layout of the room. Here's my official map of Encounter 1. Shout out to Nox Aeterno on Twitter, who gave me his original map, which I have modified. There's two main areas on the map, a light side, which has all these brightly illuminated pipes, I guess, and there's a dark side, which is dimly lit, and it has a bunch of IT server-looking things. The third and final area is the basement, which eventually one, maybe two players, may need to venture down into. Divide your team up as follows: three players in the light room and three in the dark. One player from each side must volunteer in advance to be a scanner, i.e. the yellow buff we briefly talked about at the beginning of the video, and one player from each side must volunteer to be an operator, i.e. the red buff we briefly talked about. For now, the final two players can focus on ad clearing, but should still know what is going on. The encounter begins when a player on the light side picks up the red operator buff, which is waiting to be grabbed from the glowing augmentation terminal. The doors separating the rooms will close and lock, and each side begins to kill Fallen. Keep your eyes peeled in the dark room for a vandal with the yellow symbol above his head like this. He is holding the scanner buff, so kill him, and whichever player in the dark room volunteers to be their side's scanner will pick up that buff. Here is your job as the scanner on the dark side. There are four tiny little windows that allow you to look down into the basement. There are 10 keypads down in the basement, 5 on the light side and 5 on the dark side, that need to be properly identified and eventually shot. The scanner is the person who will identify them, and they will do that again by seeing through the floor which ones are glowing yellow. Refer again to our map. Each keypad has a specific name and callout, which, trust me, is going to make things easy. So, for the dark side, which goes first, the scanner will be peering through the floor windows, and when they find their two keypads that happen to be glowing yellow, they will call those out loud. For example, the scanner might call out, "Dark 2 and Dark 5 are glowing." That is your job. And who are you calling this information out to? That would be the operator, aka the player who picked up the red buff at the very beginning. While everybody is busy killing Fallen, you, the operator, need to head to the far end of the room and shoot the glowing red keypad to open the doors that will lead you to the basement. While down in the basement, you need to be actively listening for the scanner's callouts. So in our previous example, when the scanner player in dark room called out keypads Dark 2 and Dark 5 were glowing yellow, the operator runs to those keypads in the basement and shoots them. Again, refer to the map to learn which keypads are which so you can find them quickly. Okay, back upstairs. After the scanner in the dark room has successfully given their two callouts, they have to go to their room's augmentation terminal and dunk the scanner power into the terminal. Be sure to say out loud when you've done so. Now, the player who volunteered to be scanner in the light room, head to your augmentation terminal and pick up the scanner power. Now you are the scanner in your room, so same deal. You look through the four floor windows in the light side room and try to identify which two keypads are glowing yellow. When you see which ones are glowing yellow, call them out to your friend the operator, who by now should still be running around in the basement. The operator shoots the two correct keypads on the light side, and then when all four keypads have been shot, the operator, still in the basement, heads to the augmentation terminal in the basement, dunks the operator power, and calls out that they have done so. Whoever volunteered to be an operator at the beginning on the dark side, pick up the operator power now from your augmentation terminal. Now, whoever has the scanner power upstairs, should be someone in the light side room, dunk the scanner power into the terminal, and the basement player, still downstairs, pick up the scanner power from the terminal. Basement player, now that you have the scanner power, you must now look at these electric looking currents sticking out of the wall to tell which one is glowing yellow. There's 3 on the light side and 3 on the dark side, and whichever one is glowing yellow, that's the electric fuse that the players upstairs must now inflict heavy DPS on. Your very scientific callouts are dark left, dark middle, dark right, and, get ready, light left, light middle, and light right. Very scientific. Upstairs players, when you hear these callouts, shoot the correct fuse like mad. Again, the left, middle, or right one on whichever room was called. Lightning quick teams will be able to one phase, but no problem if you don't. When DPS phase is over, the fuses will be recovered by protective glass, and you're back at step one. Oh, but by the way, basement player, you should now come upstairs, and whoever was holding onto the operator buff upstairs now runs down to the basement and becomes the new operator. Rinse and repeat. The scanner looks through the little windows on the floor to identify and call out the glowing keypads. When they do that, they dunk their scanner power into the terminal. The other scanner in the other room now picks up the power, looks through the floor windows, and makes their callouts. The operator runs around the basement and shoots the four keypads that have been called out, then dunks the operator power into the terminal. Someone upstairs, doesn't matter who, takes the operator power, and whoever the scanner player is dunks the scanner power into the terminal, and the basement player picks up the scanner power to properly identify and call out which remaining fuses need to be shot. The upstairs players DPS whichever remaining fuse is called out, and when they are all destroyed, boom, encounter over. A few extra things to take note of. The operator in the basement has about 1 minute or so to shoot all four keypads or everybody dies, so don't drag your feet too much on that. During the DPS phase, the doors to both rooms are open, so players can go back and forth to whichever room they want. When DPS phase is over though, go back to patrolling your room before the doors close. Servitors will periodically appear in both light and dark room, which blocks your ability to pass the buffs between terminals. And we can't have that, so make sure that killing servitors is a 100% priority. For good DPS, you could use any of the following for good damage: a slug shotgun with Vorpal weapon, a sniper with perks like triple tap or fourth times the charm. You could use the fourth horseman or the xenophage. You actually have a lot of good DPS options. Maybe just don't bring anything like a grenade launcher or a rocket launcher for damaging the fuses. Nothing with big splash damage, because that might kill you. Titan bubbles and warlock wells are a great help too. Now we're on to encounter 2, and please believe me when I tell you this. If you can beat this encounter smoothly, it is mostly downhill from here. Your goal in this encounter is to kill Atrax 1, a fallen exo who loves to make replicants of himself. The encounter has two main areas. Area 1, we usually call downstairs. For the most part, three players will hang out downstairs and can float back and forth between the left side of the room, the middle side, and the right side. The other area is upstairs, or if you prefer, space team. Like downstairs, the outer space area has sort of a left side, middle side, and right side. You can go back and forth between downstairs and upstairs by riding these drop pods, or elevators, that take you from one floor to the other. There are four pods total, and only one player can ride a pod at one time. The two main roles from the previous encounter are back, operator and scanner. Divide your team as follows. Pick three players for team downstairs, and three players for space team. One player on space team must volunteer to be the operator, aka the red buff, and one player on both the upstairs team and the downstairs team, so two players total, must volunteer to be the scanner, aka the yellow buff. Begin the encounter by sending your three players on space team over to the drop pod area and by touching the glowing purple aura. More on that purple shiz later. Atrax will spawn in, give it a few seconds, the drop pods will come down, and your three players on space team will hop into the pods and head upstairs. Kill adds from a safe range and play the waiting game until servitors appear. Three servitors will appear in the downstairs area first, one on the left, one in the middle, and one on the right. Team downstairs, kill all three, and keep an eye out for a fallen carrying the red operator buff. Kill that fallen, pick up the operator buff, and dunk it into any of the three augmentation terminals located in the downstairs area. You won't be able to do that, however, until all the servitors, both upstairs and downstairs, are dead. Them living blocks the terminals from being used. When all three servitors downstairs have been killed, three servitors will now spawn in the upstairs outer space area, one in the top left area, one in the top right, and one in the lower middle area. We usually like to keep one servitor alive for a little bit when we get ready, because killing the final servitor triggers the boss. More on that in a minute. While killing two of the three upstairs servitors, keep an eye out for a vandal holding the yellow scanner buff. Kill that vandal, and whoever volunteered to be the upstairs scanner, pick up your buff. When you've got the scanner buff, kill the third and final servitor upstairs. When you do this, the Atrax clones will freak out and begin glowing. This is a wipe mechanic. Whoever has the scanner buff, your job is to now quickly look around and identify which of the Atrax clones you need to attack. It should be the one glowing yellow. Call out to your upstairs teammates which one is the one glowing yellow and damage the hell out of it until you stop the wipe mechanic. Even after Atrax teleports away, keep damaging the purple cloud left in its wake. You can still deal damage for longer than you think. By the way, downstairs team, while team upstairs is engaging with Atrax, now that all the servitors are dead, feel free to dunk the red operator buff into the now open terminal. When team upstairs is done damaging Atrax, the player who volunteered to be operator upstairs will go pick up the operator buff. When you get that buff, operator, just so you don't forget to do it later, turn around and send three pods back downstairs by shooting three red keypads. That isn't vital to do it right away, but the downstairs players will need them at some point. Okay, back to team upstairs, who just finished damaging Atrax for the first time. When Atrax blinks away, he leaves you a terrible parting gift, a glowing purple orb that you have to touch and pick up. Touching it gives you a debuff called Atrax 1 Replication. Again, you have to pick this up, or everyone will eventually die. When one player has this debuff, your goal is to get it the hell off the ship. Literally, you have to get the debuff knocked off of you and sucked out of the ship via an airlock, like in the movie Alien or something. Here's how that works. The airlocks are only usable in the upstairs area. The doors to the airlocks can only be opened by the operator, who shoots the glowing red keypad to open the door to the airlock. The debuff guardian walks in, the air starts whooshing, the operator literally shoots the glowing purple buff off of your head, and it gets sucked off into outer space. Make sure you come back inside the ship after getting debuffed, or you'll get sucked out too. If at any point a player's debuff timer is so low that they're about to die, and they're nowhere near the airlock, remember that the operator can actually just shoot the debuff off of your head temporarily, and you can re-pick it up, which refreshes your timer back to 40. But again, you want to get that debuff sucked off of the ship. Okay, back to the encounter. Team upstairs has disrupted Atrax by attacking the yellow one, who the scanner identified. Scanner player upstairs, immediately after you effed up Atrax, head to a terminal and dunk the scanner power. Be sure to call out when you've done so. Downstairs team, when the upstairs player dunks the scanner power, whoever volunteered to be the scanner downstairs, it is your time to shine. Grab the scanner power from the nearest terminal. There should be three terminals downstairs. And you must now identify which of the Atrax clones is the one secretly glowing yellow. Call out which one it is, run over to it with your downstairs team, and damage the bejesus out of it to disrupt the wipe mechanic. When Atrax teleports away, same deal. He'll leave behind a purple glowing debuff that must be collected. Whoever picks up that Atrax debuff, you gotta jump into a pod and head upstairs. Find your friendly teammate who is the operator and have them shoot the debuff off of you in the nearest available airlock. Remember, there are four airlocks and each one can only be used once until the mid-encounter reset where every airlock gets refreshed. More on that in a minute. If you're a downstairs player and your debuff has been successfully removed, be sure to head back to your pod and ride it back downstairs. Okay, back downstairs. Scanner player, after your team damaged the hell out of the glowing yellow Atrax, you now run over to the nearest terminal and dunk that scanner power. See what we're doing here? We're passing the scanner power back and forth between upstairs and downstairs after every damage phase. Upstairs scanner player, grab the scanner power from the nearby terminal and once again find the Atrax clone who is secretly glowing yellow. Call it out to your team and damage the hell out of it until you interrupt the wipe mechanic. One player collects the remaining debuff, they head to a nearby air vent with their friendly operator. Operator opens the door by shooting the number pad, shoots the debuff off of them, it gets sucked out into space, rinse and repeat. I should mention that if the scanner can help it, try to not pick up the debuff after damaging Atrax. It's not the end of the world if you end up getting the debuff, just remember that if you have the scanner power and the debuff, your priority is dunking the scanner power into the terminal before finding your friend the operator to remove your debuff. Not sending the scanner ASAP between downstairs and upstairs means the other team doesn't know which Atrax to damage, which leads to a dead fire team. Dunk the scanner, then deal with the debuff. So, after four Atrax clones have been whacked, that's a mid-encounter reset, meaning the airlocks upstairs get refreshed, which the operator is happy about, and also more servitors come back. Three downstairs, and when they're dead, three upstairs. Again, when the third servitor is killed on the upstairs area, the Atrax clones begin their wipe mechanic extravaganza. The scanner calls out which one is yellow and needs to be damaged, and you damage it until it stops. When you've finally done enough damage to get to the final little chunk of the boss's health, which you'll notice right away at the beginning of the encounter on the health bar, things get interesting. At that point, everyone on team downstairs rush over to the pods and get upstairs pronto. Operator upstairs, before final damage phase, double check to make sure that at least three pods are waiting downstairs. Remember, you have the power to send the pods down by shooting the keypads. The final damage phase now happens upstairs, and it's the same as before. Whoever has the scanner buff at this point, you need to find which Atrax is glowing yellow, call it out, and put the hurt on him. Don't panic. You actually have more time to do this than you think, so don't freak out and shoot every Atrax you see, because damaging the wrong one speeds up how quickly your team will get wiped. Wait for the scanner to call out which one is the proper one to damage. Everyone gang up on that one and F it up. It may teleport away, and if it does, keep calling out which Atrax is glowing yellow and damaging it until the encounter is over. If you do enough damage to the first Atrax in the final damage phase, you don't need to worry about finding which one will be glowing next, because you'll have done enough damage to kill him, and the encounter will be over. Extra info and tips on this encounter. Scanner people always call out when you've dunked the scanner power, and that is always the priority over getting rid of your debuff. Damage-wise, if you have the brand new Lament Sword, aka the Chainsaw Sword, that does comically high damage to everything in the game, including Atrax. Insta-killing Atrax is honestly such a breeze with this sword, and I recommend highly that at least a few people use it for this encounter. With that encounter over, a door opens up in the upstairs area that takes you literally out into outer space. It's kind of a jumping puzzle. Make your way to the other side of the ship by carefully jumping from ledge to ledge to ledge. While you're outside, make sure to pick up the second hidden chest. Hidden might be a bad word, it's right out in the open, and on the way. And then eventually we will get to the third encounter, Rapture. Your goal here is not to damage or kill Taniks, but to interrupt his plan of blowing up Europa. You'll do this by dunking nuclear cores, or bombs if you want to use a shorter term, into bins near the middle of the room where Taniks is standing. This will be the first time we make use of the suppressor buff that I mentioned at the beginning of the video, and the first time that all three buffs will be on the field at the same time. Unlike the other encounters, where we initially divide teams by location, here we are going to divide players by roles. Divide your team as follows. You'll have one primary operator and one backup operator, one primary scanner and one backup scanner, and one primary suppressor and one backup suppressor. I will explain why each role needs a backup in a minute. When the encounter begins, Fallen will pour into the room. Start off by killing as many of them as you can. While killing them, keep your eyes peeled for three Fallen carrying the operator, scanner, and new suppressor buffs. Reminder that even though you haven't seen it yet, the suppressor buff is blue. When you kill the Fallen carrying those buffs, the primary operator, scanner, and suppressor should pick up their buffs accordingly. The player with the operator buff needs to be on the lookout for two glowing red keypads. There should be one on the left area of the room, one on the right. Shooting a glowing red keypad reduces the number of bombs that spawn into the room from 3 to 2, making the encounter more manageable. When the operator shoots a red keypad and two bombs spawn into the room, any two of the backup players, i.e. the backup suppressor, or the backup operator, or the backup scanner, should move quickly to pick up both bombs. Not picking up the bombs quickly will result in a team wipe. When the bombs have been collected, whoever has the scanner buff, you need to be looking at the four bins near the front of the room by Taniks. Two of the four bins will be glowing yellow. See where this is going? The two glowing yellow are where both bombs need to be dunked. However, players holding those bombs can't dunk them into the proper bins until Taniks, the big bad boss, has been interrupted by the suppressor. Suppressor player, you'll notice three orb-like security drones in the room, two up on rafters high above the floor, and the third in the dead center of the room. In order to interrupt Taniks, the suppressor needs to shoot him three times, once underneath each of the three security drones. You can't do this immediately when the encounter begins. You'll know the time is right when each drone is projecting yellow light and casting a small circle on the floor. When standing underneath the drone, you'll notice that Taniks is now glowing blue, meaning it's your time to shine. Shoot him literally one time. You don't need to hit him with cracked out big damage. One shot from your primary weapon is fine. Then move on to the other two drones and repeat. When you shoot Taniks from the final drone, he will become interrupted and stunned, and the players holding the nuclear bombs will now be allowed to dunk them into the proper bins, as called out by the scanner. Just FYI for the callouts on the bins, my team went with L1, L2, and R1, R2, like the paddles on a SCUF controller, using promo code Fallout for 5% off your order, L2 and R2 being the closest to Taniks and the windows at the front of the room. Quick note for the Brave Guardians carrying the nuclear bombs to be dunked into the appropriate bins. You'll notice you have a debuff on the bottom left called Radiation. If that number gets all the way up to 10, you will die. If, for some reason, the suppressor is moving very slowly and hasn't stunned Taniks yet, preventing the bomb people from dunking, remember that anyone not doing anything can walk up to any bomb carrier and take the bomb right out of their hands. That'll come into play a little more in the final encounter, but you can do it here too if things are taking too long and someone is about to die from level 10 radiation. You can take the bomb from them to reduce their cooldown. So, operator shoots the numbered keypad. Two bombs come out. The backup players rush to pick up the two bombs. The scanner tells you where to dunk the bombs. The suppressor stuns the boss by shooting him once from underneath all three security drones, you dunk the bombs into the bins, and that's it. You have to repeat that entire process 5 times to complete the encounter. Ready for a little twist? Sure you are. Every time the suppressor stuns the boss, which again is mandatory for beating the encounter, a random player on the team will have their buff disabled, meaning that if you're the operator or the scanner or even the suppressor, you could get your own buff disabled. You'll know your buff has been disabled because it will say so on your screen. You need to keep your eye out for this each and every time because you will screw up and fail if you don't pay attention and miss it. Whoever's buff has been disabled, run over to the nearest augmentation terminal and dunk your buff into it. Remember at the beginning how each role has a backup player? Guess what, backup player? You're up. Head over to the terminal and pick up that buff. It's your job now. So if the operator has their operator buff disabled, they run over, dunk it at the terminal, and the backup operator heads to any terminal to pick up that buff. You're bringing the buff back to life with the power of terminal dunking and friendship. Again, a random player's buff will be disabled every time the suppressor stuns the boss, so keep your eyes peeled. When you've done this whole bomb dunking spiel 6 times total, I believe, the floor in the middle of the room will open up, fall down that hole, and run to the end of a hallway while Taniks chases you. One player needs to make it to the end of the hallway before the doorway closes. Just run, you'll be fine. We're in the endgame. Walk through the darkness to your next area, and this is the final encounter with Big Bad Taniks flying around the area in a godly little robo-chariot body. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Your goal in the final encounter, kill Taniks. You will accomplish this by dunking nuclear bombs into bins, like before, until the damage phase happens, where you will unload into him with your hardest hitting weapons. The encounter has 3 main areas, the orange area, the blue area, and the spawn area. Granted, the spawn area looks kind of blue, but it's more whitish, I think. Anyway, just go with orange, blue, and spawn. Each area has 2 bins. Divide your team as follows. 2 guardians will begin in the orange area. One of them will be the first suppressor. The other will be the backup suppressor. 2 guardians will begin in the blue area. One of them will be the first scanner, and the other will be backup scanner. 2 guardians will begin in the spawn area. One of them will be, can you guess, first operator, and the other will be backup operator. Begin the encounter by shooting the trash pile in the middle of the map where Taniks is only hanging out briefly because he has no house. Fallen will run into the area, begin killing them. Eventually, 3 Fallen will come out with the operator, scanner, and suppressor buffs. The way each team is positioned makes things easier because the operator Vandal always comes out near spawn, the scanner Vandal always comes out near blue, and the suppressor vandal always comes out near orange. Kill them and have the players acting as the first operator, scanner, and suppressor pick up their buffs. At this point, the player with the scanner power look around the map to see which two of the six available bins are glowing yellow. There are two bins in each section of the map, two in orange, two in blue, and two in spawn. There are a few ways to call out these bins, but the easiest way my team has now settled on is giving each of them a number. The left bin on spawn side of the map is 1, the one on its right is 2, and then you go clockwise around the map in a circle, meaning the blue bins are 3 and 4, and the orange bins are 5 and 6. So the scanner player will look to see which bins are glowing yellow, and calls out their numbers to the rest of the team. Remember those numbers for when it's time to dunk the bombs. Now Taniks will float around a while before the four corners of his robo-chariot will glow orange. When this happens, you will shoot them until they break and drop a nuclear bomb. Note, you'll eventually shoot all four corners, but you will do it in waves of two. I recommend shooting the front two corners of his chariot first, then the back two. That way the whole fire team is focusing their fire more effectively. Oh, and while you're shooting his chariot, avoid the giant purple pillars of death that he rains down from above upon you. If you stand in a purple area for too long, you're dead, so avoid that. Okay, so you shoot the two front orange corners until they break, dodging the purple death, and eventually the two nuclear bombs pop out onto the ground. During this phase, the primary operator and the primary suppressor have important jobs to do. If you are one of the four guardians who is not currently the primary operator or the primary suppressor, guess what? It is time for you to step up to the plate. Even you, Scanner. Two of the available four guardians will run and pick up the two bombs. You will now try to move very quickly to the two bins called out earlier by the Scanner, your goal being to dunk a bomb into each bin. Oh, but Fallout, how are four guardians gonna move two bombs? Oh, I'll get to that. While running with the bombs, Taniks is going to make your life difficult. He will randomly pick one bomb runner and trap them within a purple bubble. The only way to break out of the purple bubble is for the operator to shoot the bubble. Only one shot from any gun is fine, but only the operator can do it. When trapped, call out to the operator, who will shoot the bubble and free you. This will happen more than once, by the way, so operator, be on guard. Bomb runners, your bomb journey is always going to be long, and while you're running, your two teammates, not named the operator or the suppressor, should be relatively near you while you run with the bomb. Why? Well, when your radiation debuff gets to about 6 or 7, you should tell your teammate who should run over and grab the bomb out of your hands and deliver it the rest of the way for you. Do you need to do this? Technically no, but again, it's very good to do, because if the radiation debuff gets to 10, the bomb runner will die. So each bomb runner have a partner and hand the bomb off. Every guardian has something they need to do. Speaking of which, suppressor guardian, like the operator, you can't concern yourself with the bomb carrying right now, because you need to move quickly and stun Taniks. If you don't do this, the bins won't open and the bomb carriers will die because they can't dunk their bombs. So whichever side of the map Taniks goes to, you follow him there. When Operation Bomb Carry begins, it's like the last encounter. You have to go under 3 of the security drones in that area and shoot Taniks just once under each. Shooting him under the 3rd security drone in that area will stun him, allowing the bombs to be dunked. However, just like the last encounter, every time you stun Big Daddy Taniks, guess what? A random player will have their buff deactivated. And just like the encounter before, when that happens, find out which player it was, go to a nearby terminal, dunk your dead buff into the terminal, and have your backup player go there and pick up the buff. To make this a little easier, you know how Operator shoots and breaks the void bubble that randomly traps a bomb carrier? When the second void bubble gets popped by the Operator, that's usually the moment where our suppressor player shoots Taniks from the 3rd security orb in that area, stunning him. Now we do it that way because in the event that the suppressor moves too quick and stun Taniks too quickly, it would be a bad and annoying thing if the player who lost their buff was the operator, who's currently trying their best to make sure that the bubbled players aren't remaining bubbled. So Suppressor, shoot Taniks from two drone spots, wait for the operator to break two void bubbles, then finish stunning Taniks from the third drone. So the bomb thing happens twice. First, the two bombs on the front of his chariot get ran across the map and dunked. Then the two back bombs get shot off the chariot and then dunked. When all four bombs have been dunked, it is finally DPS time. Head to the top of the map, i.e. the spawn area, and wait by the big rock. Titan players, if you have a Ward of Dawn, i.e. Titan bubble, now would be a good time to drop it near that big rock. Taniks will summon a big blue tornado-y thing. You will need to step into that tornado before shooting him, but don't get too close. There's actually two layers to the tornado, an outer layer and an inner layer. You want to be right in the middle. Picture a donut with frosting. You want to be on the frosting of the donut, not in the center of the donut hole. Going too close to the center of the tornado will cause you to die. When in the tornado, it is damage time. I'll give recommendations after explaining the encounter, but yeah, hit him hard and don't stop. Eventually, he'll have a brief immune phase, and if you shoot him during that phase, he'll ground pound you out of his little bubble. But really, who cares? Reacquire your Titan bubble damage buff and get back into his tornado. My team usually likes to jump into the tornado from the rock, by the way. If you notice, there's trash and debris swirling around the outside of the tornado, and if you're not paying attention, you can get smacked by it when trying to enter the tornado, and you will die. So if you're worried about that, just jump from the rock. It is easier to avoid the swirling debris, IMHO. So he ground pounds you out, you jump back in, and more damage. Keep shooting and shooting and shooting until he gets damage gated, and then it is rinse and repeat. Remember before, when a player randomly gets their buff deactivated by Taniks after getting suppressed? Well, if it's DPS phase, do not re-swap your buff with your backup player until after DPS phase is over. It's just easier that way. But yeah, anyway, after DPS phase, rinse and repeat. Everyone goes back to their stations and you do the whole bomb carrying shebang all over again. Remember, operator and suppressor are never going to pick up the bombs. That's what the other four guardians are for. Relay racing the bombs to the dunk points as called out by the scanner. When you finally do enough damage to Taniks to get him to his final smidge of health, he'll freak out and enter final damage phase where he randomly teleports around the map like an asshole. At this point, hit him with anything and everything you have. Power weapons, special weapons, roaming supers, whatever. Damage him until he is dead, all while again avoiding the purple pillars of death and raid over. Final tips and loadout recommendations for Taniks. I highly, highly recommend one player brings a Divinity Trace Rifle. Hitting Taniks with it turns him into a squishy, soft biatch. The blue crit orb caused by Divinity shows up bright and clear underneath his robo chariot. For those on your team who will focus on damage rather than Divinity, take your pick between the following. A sniper rifle with either a triple tap or fourth times the charm. If you have it, the Adored Sniper works really great here. A slug shotgun with Vorpal Weapon, maybe the Izanagi's Burden, and of course, Anarchy. Anarchy is especially great because you can pair it with either a hard-hitting sniper or a slug shotgun. The protocol, if you're using Anarchy, by the way, is to fire two Anarchy prongs into Taniks directly, then take out your sniper or shoddy, and direct your attention to shooting the Divinity crit bubble. If no one has the Divinity, slightly more annoying, but you'll be fine. I believe Taniks' normal crit spot is his head. Just unload into that with your sniper or shoddy, but again, strongly recommend that somebody has the Divinity. If no one does, maybe bring a Tether Hunter to debuff Taniks during the damage phase. And as long as one player, maybe two, has either a Well of Radiance or a Bubble Titan for extra damage output on Taniks, everyone else can be a roaming super, either for ad control or for doing reliable damage to Taniks at the very end during his spazzing out around the map phase. And that's it. With all this info, I guarantee you can ace the Deep Stone Crypt raid even if you have never raided before. And for the record, this is a great raid to learn. One of my favorites. Very interesting mechanically and cool visual flair. Grab your friends who are too scared to raid and show them this video. You can and will be able to do this. Good luck and happy raiding. Please do me a solid and like this video if you enjoyed it, And if you haven't already subscribed to my channel, helps me out a bunch, and hey, means I'll make more content for you. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.